We starting with our question and answer session. And to proceed with that, may I also please invite Professor Kellett, Professor Bickley, Professor Newman, as well as Dr. Lina Chan to take their seats on stage. This next session will be moderated by Ms. Sophia Arai, the Deputy Director of Research from the Center of Livable Cities. Now, if you have a question in mind for our expert speakers, please do raise your hand and to wait for the moderator to allow you to go ahead. There are microphones and aisles. And please state your name and the organization you are from before asking your question. And so I'll now hand over the session to Ms. Sophia. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Hassan. And we've heard from a most impressive lineup of speakers this morning. We've got a huge crowd. I don't want to delay the Q&A. I'm sure you're all raring to go with questions. We've heard from Steve, we've heard from Tim, Peter, Lina, and Leonard, all esteemed leaders in the fields, professors and practitioners alike. So there are mics on the aisles. Without further ado, can I have the first question, maybe? Anyone? You just raise your hands first. Right. Sarah.
Hi, thank you so much for organizing this event and for your presentations. Professor Kellert, I was struck, you mentioned multiple times in your presentation that the evidence is, or the research is relatively thin, although there's a large amount of it, it's thin. I just wondered what you think it is about the biophilia aspect that has led to the research being so thin, and what resources can be put towards making it thicker.
Academics are always calling for more research, but we are an evidence-based society. We may be the first society in human history that has to have proven to them that nature is important, but nonetheless, without that demonstration of evidence, whether it be economic or ecological or social, it's very difficult to make large-scale policy changes, especially in our world. We do things on a very large scale and we do it very quickly. And so our mistakes, when we make them, are you know, very difficult to undo. And so we have to be very systematic and proactive in our designs and our plans, because of the scale of our impacts. And I think in order to create the momentum for large-scale change, we need to have the data that demonstrates that indeed there's a benefit. And that, you know, people will do a certain amount because reasons of ethics or altruism, but self-interest is the greatest motivator. And I don't mean selfishness, but self-interest. And so if we can demonstrate that there's health, productivity, and well-being, and quality of life impacts, I think we can create a greater momentum of change. Now, why that hasn't been done is difficult to say. I think Professor Newman, who understands social change, can better answer that than I can. But like many movements, it starts with a kind of a sort of idealism and a missionary zeal and some visionary thinking, and there isn't a great deal of interest in research. And research is expensive. It takes time. Once a project is built, there's usually very little resources that are available or allocated beforehand to assess impacts. Most developers are on to the next project, and most developers, especially large-scale urban development, there isn't a lot of incentive to do research. In fact, most developers, the money is coming from all over the world. They're looking for a return on investment as quickly as possible. They probably don't have much of a stake in the long term. So there's much, you know, they might build the property and then sell it, or flip it, as they say. And so there isn't a great deal of motivation for them to do that kind of assessment. And projects are done one at a time rather than a large scale. So I think that in Singapore, you have the opportunity, it seems to me, if you, with a few very significant large-scale projects, to think about generating the evidence before and after to demonstrate the impact and build that into the program to begin with, especially if you want to leverage those impacts over time, not only in Singapore, but globally. But all these together make it difficult to provide the resources and the commitment to do the kind of research that needs to occur, the evidence that needs to be presented to encourage others to innovate these, implement these kinds of changes.
Sorry, I don't want to hog the microphone, but just that's really useful. I'm asking from the perspective of being a research fellow at Q's Research within the National Parks Board, and just wondered, or maybe the rest of the panelists, in your discussion as you go forward, I'd love to hear some specific homework for us in terms of key metrics and key parameters for research studies that we need to achieve your thickness requirement. Maybe not now, maybe later.
Maybe if anyone? Yeah, Peter?
We had a research project in the National Research Organization. It was a scoping study, and it was on biophilic urbanism. We wanted to be able to show what the potential was. It wasn't taken up by the research organization and followed on into further work and further money. And the key word that was used, why not, was that it's too soft. Now, sometimes soft is good, but in this particular case, engineering-oriented people who didn't see it as that useful, it sort of didn't quite, it wasn't hard enough. Now, if I was going to give some advice, I would say what I said in my presentation, that we need to do the economics of it very clearly. So, show that there's a hard edge to it. This actually will save businesses money and it will save cities money. It will be part of a productivity and health agenda. It is not just looking nice. If it's just looking nice, it's soft. And I do think that we are way beyond that. But it has to look nice too. In many ways, what Leonard gave is an example of how water-sensitive urban design has gone from being a bit soft and nice to being very hard-edged, because it demonstrates it's very good engineering. We haven't yet done that, I think, in terms of the building-oriented biofilms.
I just might add, it's an interesting time to build on my earlier comment about citizen science and using technology. I mean, it's really fun to think about how that, how we are in a new world where we can collect a lot of information about people and what they're thinking and feeling in real time using iPhones, for example. So some of you know about the Mappiness project in the UK. Thousands of people who responded. They get pings, you know, several times during the day, and they you know, we can debate the rigor of those sort of metrics, but it's interesting. The one conclusion, actually, from one big conclusion from the Mappiness project is that people are happiest when they're actually in a natural setting. That's one of the conclusions. So I also think about I have a new colleague, a new faculty member at UVA, Jenny Rowe, who has done all of this, a lot of the leading research looking at the use of portable EEG caps and walking people through cities and seeing what parts of the brain light up and kind of, you know, focusing in a little bit more on the brain and the neuroscience associated with nature. And we have a long way to go to understanding what all that means. But horrible EEG caps, you know, the price of them coming down, and you can wear them now in a way that, you know, it's not a big, clunky, huge thing any longer. So I guess I'm encouraged that there's so many more technologies and opportunities to do in, you know, real-time research and monitoring in cities. And so really exciting, I think, promise.
Maybe another question, perhaps, from the floor? Yes, gentleman in the back.
Thank you all for your talk. It was very interesting. I've got some questions that I've jotted down. This one's for Professor Keller. Professor Keller, precisely how close to nature or natural design should individuals be in order to reap benefits they suggested by philanthropic welfare? Is it enough for people to visit parks, say, once a week, or do they have to physically see trees in front of their houses when they return home every day? I'm asking this because in my experience as a manager on the ground, I've encountered many individuals who are frustrated by our public trees shedding leaves into their gardens, mm-hmm. or birds pooping on their cars, or being woken up by birds in the night. Therefore, from the perspective of biophila, how would you recommend we address these problems at the interface between man and nature? And I've got another question for Professor Beasley, which I think I'll ask after.
Did you get this?
Well, I hope I got that all. It's a big question. Well, I do think that the, if I interpreted what you asked correctly, you know, parks are great things. I mean, obviously, we saw some, you know, Lena's description of the amount of open space and protected areas that you have here in Singapore, New York City, you know, a very highly urbanized environment with very little systematic planning by comparison, nonetheless has, I think, 18% of its area in designated parks and over 25% in open space in one form or another. The wonderful restoration that we heard about, which I thought was Leonard's presentation, you know, extraordinary, very inspirational, and I'm left in awe of what you've accomplished here. Nonetheless, I think that the problem with inherent problem with parks or the concept of parks is that it tends to reinforce a number of dichotomies that I think we need to somehow break down. You know, one is that nature is there in the parks, and humans are here, and there's two different worlds, nature and humans. They're different. Humans aren't nature. And nature is something that you visit when you have the time and opportunity and motivation, which doesn't always occur, and if it does occur, it's usually on a very intermittent and occasional basis. And then it reinforces another dichotomy that nature is out there. You know, nature's outside, and where we are here is something else. You know, this is where humans live, and it's not nature. And since we spend 90% of our time here, that's a problem in and of itself. And so somehow we need to address these, recognize that these are very formidable dichotomies and separations. And as great and as important as nature is out there, it's experientially rich, it's diverse, it's multisensory, it's got all kinds of qualities that are very difficult to incorporate into the everyday indoor experience. Nonetheless, we need to translate that experience, that occasional experience of visiting nature in a rich outdoor setting into the context of our everyday lives, and bring it into the spaces that we inhabit in terms of work and where we live and where we are educated and so forth. And it's not going to be an easy process. It's a very challenging engineering and conceptual process, but that's important. The other thing, I think that's another dichotomy that we need to address, that Professor Newman alluded to just recently, is that we tend to think of nature as an aesthetic experience or maybe a recreational experience. Again, an amenity and decoration. And that's important, but there, you know, as I try to indicate, there are many layers, levels, and dimensions of our inherent connection to nature, and they're all legitimate. And the more multidimensional is our connection, the richer and more satisfying is the experience. So growing things is important. Controlling our environment is important. Recognizing that there's fear of aversion, as was referred to, in certain kinds of habitats, and that needs to be addressed. And that can be turned into a positive. But all those different levels of relationship that are not just aesthetics. And the more levels of connection you have, the more the benefit, the more the value. I mean, value is measured ecologically as well as economically and socially. So I'm not trying to suggest that this is so complex we can't resolve the challenge, but it is complex. It's not going to be simply creating another park, as difficult as that is, or restoring a species, or providing an opportunity to see some, you know, rare and beautiful creature. There needs to be a greater sense of integration and engagement between the people and nature, so that the two systems are complementary and mutually reinforcing.
Can I just jump in before you ask the thing? What you perhaps could do is enable the people who are being woken up by the birds to find out what sort of birds they are and how important those birds are in that ecosystem, to actually start to relate to them a little bit more, to understand the trees in that neighbourhood and why they do need to be occasionally trimmed and so on, but actually the wild altogether in terms of the habitat that's in those trees. So the bit of education perhaps could help a lot in enabling that process to be a little bit more connected to their innate connections.
I would just piggyback on that. We've been doing these bird walks lately, and your point about, well, birds are pooping, and that's, you know, they don't like birds. And when I talk about my connections with birds, not everybody gets it. But when we get them on the bird walks, and we slow them down, and we have birders who can, you know, point out, well, here's how you listen first, then look, and here's how you use the binoculars, and oh wow, that's really incredible. And now at the end of the bird walk, they comfortably can identify 10 species, and they know something about them and how important they are, and they have a connection. I think it's back to your point about this being a weak tendency that we have. It takes education and reinforcement and opportunities to have fun and to connect. And so one of the challenges, I think, in thinking about a biophilic city is how many different ways can you entice people to connect with nature, and maybe the ones that are a little skeptical in the beginning. You had another question, though.
It's quite interesting because many of our foreign visitors from ASEAN countries, when they come here for workshops, they're always amazed. What? You can actually hear quails in the morning? We can't hear that, you know, outside our hotel or outside our home, we need to actually, you know, go to somewhere far away. So I think other people actually appreciate the biodiversity in Singapore more than we do. Interestingly enough, yeah. And the parks, MParks had a survey, a park usage survey, and whether you want to believe it or not, but interestingly enough, a high percentage of people that were interviewed would want our nature reserves to be conserved, even though they don't visit it. But there's a very high percentage of people who want biodiversity conserved.
Maybe let it come in.
Yeah, we had an interesting experience when we were doing Bishan. So when we were building it, constructing it, we get letters from residents periodically. One of them will be writing, "Why is there a tree right in front of my house?" Right? And then the next week we'll get another letter and somebody will be writing, "Why isn't any tree in front of my house?" I think we have to appreciate the fact that, you know, there are diversity of opinions. Right? And this is a product of how our society has developed. We have got one generation which has been living in an environment that is really out of touch with nature. Right? And they've got a preconceived ideas about the importance of nature. And that generation takes time to be to readapt to this new environment. So this question basically is time and effort allocated. That would be my opinion.
Second question, make it a brief one.
It's an ecological question. When we simulate or recreate nature in our urban environments, to what extent should we seek to replicate the native habitats specific to that locality? Because often the manageable or aesthetically pleasing species which we select for natural design are not necessarily the native species. So from an ecological perspective, I believe there are valid concerns about feral and invasive species. Thus, could you shed some light on how we could specifically tailor biophilia to meet the objectives of conservation and restoration, or to what extent should we even try to do so?
Yeah, that's for me.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I'll start. I think you know there's a lot of controversy in your question, and a lot of heated discussion in our community about this. And my own view is we definitely need to talk about this entire kind of novel ecosystems and hybrids, and the world is different, that's for sure. But other things being equal, I would rather see native species used whenever we can. So that, and we've got fantastic examples of this. That Soho, New York project that I mentioned, I showed of the lush terraces, the green terraces. They went through a very interesting process, consulting actually with a fellow named Eric Sanderson, who's looked at what the Manhattan native plants were when Henry Hudson discovered, or not discovered, when he arrived in 1609. And so they're actually using the palette of native plants. And there are a lot of reasons why we need to favor native species where we can. And we should, definitely. But on the other hand, there's certainly either debates in a number of places around, you know, as tree species that are not native, California eucalyptic trees and other species that provide a lot of benefit. And the question becomes, how do you transition maybe from those non-natives to natives? So it's very controversial. That's my opinion. I would favor natives where we can. I know Lena has probably a similar view, but...
Allow me to answer this. I can't wait to answer this. What's your name again?
Mark,
you haven't been listening to my presentation. My presentation clearly states that you have to work with the site. I think what makes a place unique is what is special and what's unique to the site. Right? And what's unique to our outside is what's native. If we can't make do with what we have got, you think we can make do with something that occurs elsewhere? It's not a lecture, sorry, I'm just demonstrating that it is really important that we recognize what makes the space special, right? And normally that's what is found there, endemic, native. And that's what we should prioritize.
But can we do so for every site where, you know, there are many sites where we have restrictions
on, you know, what species you can plant based on size. And perhaps you could discuss this later, sir.
What?
Look, I would take the perspective that in a city you are reconstructing, regenerating, and it is very hard to just do maintenance. It is important to try, but we have areas in our wheat belt that are being regenerated to bushland, and you can't just let it go, and it won't come back because there are lots of weeds and feral species and so on. But you have to try to recreate the structure of the ecosystem that was there, because that climate is essentially going to be what determines what grows well. So in the city, you can create a different structure. Now you've got a city there that will nevertheless be consistent with what the structure of the ecosystem was before, but can have other species. Should you chop down all your rain trees? They're not a native species. Come on, they're beautiful and they are a major, important part of the Singapore ecosystem now. And they are enabling a whole lot of other species to survive and thrive there. So they work because they fit alongside of very, very narrow areas. They can grow in a city. Not all native species will. So it is a new science, urban ecology.
Okay.
You know, that's a very, very good point. And you know, to add to that, I'm glad that was said, because there is something about, we call it American motherhood and apple pie, to advocate native ecosystems and native species, and how could you be against that? But there are situations where you can demonstrate that the, you know, the net primary productivity, if you will, over time, is actually in terms of species diversity and biogeochemical flux and other measures of the ecological productivity of the system is actually enhanced and enriched, even though there's an element of novelty in the system, because you are changing, in a sense, the environment, and we're always changing the environment to some extent. But I think where the real challenge comes in, and where we have to be somewhat adaptable and flexible about the kinds of experiential interactions we have with nature, is, again, you know, this is my obsession. Nonetheless, I think we need to think about the indoor built environment just as much as the outdoor environment, if we're really serious about, you know, creating a sustained and ongoing series of interactions and relationships between people and nature on an ongoing basis. And when you do, and for example, you know, I was involved with a retrofit of a office tower in New York City, which has an atrium, and the atrium provided extraordinary opportunities to create a very rich and satisfying set of relationships and interactions between people who inhabit the space, which are mostly office workers, and this environment that they spend the majority of their time. But there was no way we could do that with native species. For one thing, in a temperate climate, native species are going to be losing their leaves for a good part of the year. It's not going to be a very satisfying environment as a consequence. So we created as something of a subtropical environment, even though it was an indigenous to the States, it certainly was indigenous to New York City where we were working. And for other reasons, we needed to think about the kind of self-sustaining ecosystem that we could create there, that would provide a rich and diverse experience for people and would be ecologically meaningful, but recognize that we couldn't really replicate what was outside inside.
That's interesting. Okay. I've just been flashed 5 minutes, but I want to keep this going. So, a question. A quick show of hands, how many questions do I have? We have 1, 2, 3. Can I take the one lady in the back? And then the two over here.
Thank you. My name is Eileen, and I'm a nature lover. Could I continue on the theme of the self-sustaining ecosystem inside? But I'd like to extend it outside, because here we promote green vertical walls. And I'm wondering if internationally there's a movement that the green vertical walls should A, become self-sustaining, be some kind of ecology, and actually grow plants that feed things. Because here it seems to be mostly about aesthetics. Short please.
Anyone wants to take that? Peter? Okay.
We certainly have examples of edible green walls that are growing things. I do think of, I'm not sure that I want to generalize about trends so much, but I think of examples in Spain and other places where they're designing green walls to treat gray water and kind of things that would do service that is a bit more than the aesthetics of it.
That's about people. I'm thinking about not just habitats, recreating habitats like the ABC Waters program does.
Right.
I'm thinking about what about the habitats that inhabit our potential habitats on the outside of our walls.
I think that we are in the early stages of this. And the science of how you make green walls work as a whole ecosystem is just developing. So what Patrick Blanc has done with his walls is try to copy waterfalls and to get species that inhabited waterfalls because they hung on the side and grew in the right way. But he was dominated by the need to make them very beautiful, and they are. They're very popular. I think that was my first image of the green walls, with Tim taking pictures in Paris outside one of Patrick Blanc's green walls. But if you really want to do biodiversity in a city, you've got to think in ecosystem structure terms, and you've got to think about how they fit together and work together, and are a system. They are part of, they're fixed to a wall of a city, but they are nevertheless dependent on each other, and they are feeding the whole ecosystem. That is not something that Patrick Blanc was doing, but nevertheless, it should be on our agenda to do. It's why it's very important that N Parks does that kind of work, because it's sort of research that was done in Hort Park to show the different kinds of green walls and how you make them operate, what kind of flows of water and nutrients you needed. That basic science was feeding into the kind of gardening aspect. But let's feed now into the full biodiversity picture and the ecosystem structure that you can build on a wall.
I think we have to take a pragmatic approach here. Because I've listed down in my talk a number of natural ecosystems, right, from rainforests and mangroves and all the rest, but they're also emerging, and it's quite obvious now, urban ecosystems. And what we find, what we are doing in Singapore, is that we take a very solutions approach. When it comes to nature reserves, to pristine ecosystems, we plant enhanced with native species. However, in things like streetscape, where it is not really native, we try our best to have native species, but at the same time, have species that can thrive, because it's a man-made environment. For example, in the last few years, we've planted more species that are from the drier climate conditions. And the bloom that occurred during that drought period and then rain was fantastic, and everybody loved it, and it was really a fantastic experience. Looking at colourful Singapore, unbelievable. I think we need that kind of thing where increase the species biodiversity, but at the same time ensure that our native biodiversity thrive because it ensures that we can adapt and mitigate to climate change conditions that we can't predict. So I think it has to be a multi-pronged approach.
Can I have the two questions, maybe the last two questions?
Hi. I'm Joseph Cole. I chair an independent scientific advisory committee on the management of our nature reserves. I want to ask not a scientific question, but a philosophical question that is addressed to all members of the entire panel. And I refer to Professor Kelly's terminology, this issue of dichotomies. Here in Singapore, I see two dichotomies. One about the greening of cities. The first dichotomy is a dichotomy between, you know, advocates who are, or what NParks is doing, you know, they're trying to build a biophilic city. There are people who say that why should we be wasting money and resources in building a biophilic city when we should be concentrating on preserving our pristine nature reserves. To me, this is a false dichotomy because you can have both. It's not a zero-sum game. It's not either choice. It's not an either-or choice. But it is a philosophical question. It is a rhetorical question. It is a political question. It can be a political question. The question is that even though it is, to many of us, it is very clear that this is a false dichotomy, this is not either or, but you know, I think some persuasion is still required to demonstrate that we can have all. What would be your advice, you know, to demonstrate that we actually need not be all, provided you agree? I think you should agree. That's the first issue of first dichotomy, because this is real, this is not political. This is not theoretical, because it goes into the debate of whether it is wise to have our park connectors, whether it is wise to have alien trees and animals in the connectors, etc. So that's the first one. The second one, probably in the context of Singapore, it is real. It is a real dichotomy, and that is because this is a small country. Our land is limited, resources are limited. We sometimes need to build around our nature reserves. Sometimes parts of it will be nibbled off, parts of it will be fragmented. But on the other hand, we want to keep the nature reserve as far as possible. So there is an issue of trade-off. I think the panel has put up a wonderful case, a powerful case, from the economic point of view, from the psychological point of view, social point of view, to build a biophilic city. Can you help to just to give some advice on how to build up a stronger case to preserve what we have in the nature reserve, rather than building something artificially? Because today we have heard a lot of arguments about the economic value, etc., of greening the city. Would you be able to give us some pointers of how do you build up a stronger case so that when we discuss trade-off, you know, the advocates who want to keep our nature reserve as pristine as possible will have a more powerful and will have more powerful ammunition.
Okay. Thank you. I think it's a question on trade-offs and how we can strengthen our arguments or to support really building biophilic city. Maybe Peter might want to get this. Yes.
There you go. Yeah. Look, I think that it is not a coincidence that the wealthiest city in the world, Singapore, has the best natural systems to enable their community to have access to nature. It is something that is innate in city building as well as innate in human beings to want to build around nature and to build it in back into the city. And I think it is part of the processes that you have achieved as building a city that is wealthy that you want to put your money into that. It is, if you go to an informal settlement that's got refugees pouring into an area, they basically destroy the local nature and just build on top of each other and just to survive. And in Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you've got to have your food and your water and your waste fixed so that you can survive. But then when you settle down, you start to build nature back into those settlements. And what has happened in Singapore is that as you have become wealthy, you have put it back into nature in a way that certainly is not going to stop. And if people are trying to stop that, I think they're against the whole ethos of city building. And so you can certainly use that argument are you wealthy because of your natural systems, or are you wealthy and therefore you build them up? I don't know, but there's certainly a close correlation. I'll leave the other.
Maybe what I'll do is we're running short of time. I mean, there's lunch. We can still catch our panelists out there. We have our panel session after lunch as well. Maybe I can get Professor Kellett to give some quick comments if you have on this, Tim and Dina and Leonard, before I close the Q&A.
The
issue of trade-offs.
Trade-offs are there, definitely. I guess I'm encouraged by the sort of mechanisms that might help to navigate that trade-off. The landscape replacement policy, for example, the green area ratio notion that when we allow land to be taken for housing, for building, we need that land. We exact something from it, right? It's a commitment to return in a sort of net positive way nature to your world, and it may not be exactly the same kind of nature, but we're moving in the restorative direction, to use Peter's terminology. So I think that's what I would encourage, overcoming dichotomies and finding common ground and those sort of mechanisms that move us in a net nature, net positive direction, I would say.
Yeah, no, I think Tim just summed it up beautifully. We're letting the cat out of the bag, if you will, when we say that you can have development in areas that are protected areas or open space areas that benefits people and nature. And there is a risk. As I said before, whenever you have development, you're going to have perturbation, you're going to have change, and you're going to have, in the short term, you're probably going to have adverse impacts. And for particularly sensitive species, that is a risk. And the easier route is to kind of create a preserve, or a preservation in an area where you have species that are relatively are highly sensitive and intolerant of human contact. Build in a sense a wall around them to protect them. And when you're saying that, we can create a mutuality between people and nature, we need to recognize that is a very difficult process to achieve, and that for certain species that's going to be problematic, and it's going to interject an element of complexity and challenge for those who are in the design business, whether it be ecological design or architectural design,
to make that occur successfully, especially over time. And so there is a, and also there, you know, there, rightfully so, there are those who, there are species that we have co-evolved with in a very problematic basis that, you know, as much as I love the picture of those mountain lions that Tim showed, I'm certain that there are many people in the San Francisco area, whether they have babies or children, pets or children, who are going to be uncomfortable with the idea of a large predator in their backyard. So how do you mitigate that, the potential for that kind of conflict? And less so with otters, but it's going to occur as well. And so there's a, again, it's an easier process to kind of segregate, people, nature, and there are wildlife ecologists and ecologists who would prefer to devote, and rightfully so, their attention on the tremendous challenge of ecological and species restoration, and independent of human preference and need and interest, let alone the economic and social development goals. And to some extent, at times, maybe that needs to occur. In an urban context, such as Singapore, I think, and given that the majority of the world's population lives in urban areas, and 80% of Americans and Australians live in urban areas, I think we have no other choice than to confront the need to address this need to reconcile the humans with nature in a mutually beneficial fashion. But it will be extremely complex, challenging, and there certainly will be, as I say, winners and losers among species. And if we think we can that won't occur, we're being naive. We need to recognize that there's going to be that reality, and maybe there are ways we can mitigate it to some degree.
Right, thank you, Professor Kellett. I know we're standing between you and lunch, so do catch, I think what we'll do is, if you have some more questions, do catch us, catch the panel at lunch, and there's also after lunch, when we have the whole panel session, there will be another round of Q&As from the floor. So thank you very much, panel, for taking the questions, and we'll break for lunch.
Thank you to all distinguished speakers and to Sophie Ng for moderating the session. So we'll now break for lunch. We'll resume the next session at 1:45. So unfortunately, we're running slightly behind time. Lunch is served outside. Have a good lunch, and we'll see you later. I request that you take your seats. Alright, we shall continue. Our next speaker is Mr. Kim Soon Hoon. He's the Chief Executive Officer of Singapore-based consultancy firm CPG Corporation. An architect by profession, he has more than 28 years of experience working on many significant landmark projects, including Gardens by the Bay, Khoo Teck Puat Hospital, and the new Supreme Court building. He's an avid butterfly enthusiast and photographer, and is one of the co-founders of the Butterfly Surfer, an online community of butterfly enthusiasts. So let us please welcome Mr. Kim on stage.
We see that the crowd has thinned out somewhat after lunch. When Lina called me one morning to ask me to speak at this, I asked her, do I speak as a nature lover or do I speak as an architect? So in my presentation, I'm going to make it biophilic by combining the two together. Right, and some of the questions that were asked before lunch, I am going to address this because I think we Singaporeans are very familiar with hard truths, right? The reality of appreciating nature, right? And all you here are only the converts. It's those people out there who are not here that we need to convert. My topic is going to focus a lot on the biodiversity aspects of it, of biophilia. And I'll start with the architectural aspects. We've heard this morning from the three learned professors about biophilic design. Just a quick recap. The connections to nature are vital to maintaining a healthful and vibrant existence, and the fundamental tenets of biophilia. Man's interventions have to be one with the natural systems. And for those of us who practice in Asia, if you look at the principles of feng shui, right, literally wind, water, and in India, if you know about Vastu, that's the geomancy, the equivalent of feng shui in India, it has a lot of fundamentals that practice biophilic design, right, respecting and embracing nature. So in Asia, we are already practicing biophilic design in various forms, right? Time immemorial. This part, when you see the economics of biophilic design, I am looking at it from the hard tools part. As a practicing architect, I've got to convince my clients that biophilic design is economically feasible for them, particularly the developers. My first question is that, you want to put in all this money, cost me extra money. Can I sell my condominium apartments at a higher price per square foot? Answer is yes. Okay, so we've got supporters amongst the private sector. The government is doing already a great job on promoting biophilic design, and we've got a formula going for Singapore because we have the bank rollers, right, investors who are convinced that biophilic design is the way to go as well. Architects like in CPG, we have also capitalized on biophilic design, embedding nature in our projects, right, to distinguish our designs, to give it the extra oomph. Right, whether it is a condominium luxury living next to a park, capitalizing a river view, or living next to the nature reserves. Right, pick up a newspaper and look at all those condominium advertisements by developers. What does it sell? No, the condominium sells a view, right, living next to nature. And quite amazingly, when the advertisements feature living next to Bukit Timah and then shows a bird from Costa Rica and a butterfly from Brazil. But, you know, the buyers are quite curious, as long as there's a butterfly and bird, fine, and living next to nature. So this appeal of this seamless connections between natures and the celebration of natural systems, right, in building typologies is becoming more prevalent in architectural design, right, from residential to industrial buildings to hospitals. I haven't tried it on the prison yet. Maybe cactus. Okay, so I'm going to present some of the designs that my firm was involved in. You've heard a lot about it. The original vision, as unfortunately the CEO has other appointments, so he's left us. He was, the primary driver of our success in biophilic design. You need a crazy big person like him. We generally challenge the architects to do something like the Depot Hospital. Right? And harnessing nature's healing power and having community engagement that involves a lot of people who visit this hospital not because they are sick, but because they enjoy the greenery in the hospital. It's a community project. Right? This is how it looks like today. Lush greenery in a hospital. It doesn't look like a hospital. I think those of you who have visited Kudepo Hospital, the first thing you should realize is that it doesn't smell like a hospital. There is very little antiseptics now in this Kudepo Hospital. they, even if you have to go to the restroom, it's surrounded by plants. There's a community garden, community farming on the rooftop, right, level 7. This is how the rooftop, the roofscape of Khoo Teck Puat Hospital looks like. And mind you, a lot of people do not realize, like I said, we need a crazy CEO like Mr. Yap to push us, because all these plants are sitting on top of 6 operating theatres. Right? Those of you who are practitioners, you know how risky it is, right? To have a flat roof, water, and imagine there are critical patients that are being operated under this roof. So it will take a lot of additional engineering architectural precautions to make sure that you can have your plants but you don't have water leaks into the operating theatre. The garden courtyard, this is in basement 1. It brings light greenery down into the basement, so the basement does not feel like a basement. It provides a sense of place, a location where patients can find solace in a hospital. The view to the pond, as you look out from the hospital, when we first started work, it was just a sorry PUB stormwater retention pond. Today it has a lot of biodiversity, the planting, community uses it, it's a jogging track around the pond. Next project, not very well known, okay, because it's a high-tech, an industrial building. It's in 1 North. Again, this the vision of this project, and we work with Dr. Ken Yang here, from Sai Yang. To start with increasing the green footprint of this site, we created a biodiversity ramp around the building, wrapping like a ribbon around the building of greenery, and to try to reinstate greenery that increase the original site that we took away from nature. And because this is a private site, it's an industrial site, right? We took the client to a lot of convincing. Like you have a client in a high-tech area wanting to maximize the GFA, and you put a green belt around the building which he can't sell. Okay, so the business proposition to him was that you're going to get higher rents because people can relate to nature. Because nature sells. So this is a perspective of the building itself, and fortunately we had a park right in front of the building which was not going to be developed. And the whole premise of the design was to capture the biodiversity, move it up a ramp that surrounds the building. And this is an interior view. Quite utilitarian for an industrial building, but still embodying greenery into that. So what we did was to replace and increase the green area, the site area, that was originally an open undeveloped site. By having this green ramp, 1.4 kilometers of green ramp, wrapping around the building and the roof gardens. Okay, today we have a lot of greenery on the rooftop. Okay, it doesn't look as sorry as this now. This was taken just when the building was completed. The landscaping is much lush now. Okay, so the terrace looking down into the green patch site next to it. How the building looks today from the road. Okay, the next case study is our latest attraction in Town Gardens by the Bay. It's a horticultural showcase. Right? There are a lot of strategies on habitat remediation. This is a 54 hectare site. 30 years ago, it was the sea. It is reclaimed land. When somebody asked me, so how many butterfly species did it increase by? It was from 0 to 52. There were no butterflies in the sea 30 years ago. Okay, today we have 52 species on site. to the green and blue strategies, and I will focus more on the biodiversity enhancement. Right? I think many of you are familiar with this, Singaporeans who have visited. I bet most of you have gone there, the conservatories and the super trees. And my last 10 visits to this site, 7 times, was here in the fragile forest. I was looking at the biodiversity and how it had improved before construction and then after construction. These are the untidy areas. Right, you can enjoy the aircon conservatories once, twice, but for you nature lovers, get out there. Look at the rest of the 54 hectares that people don't. And you don't have to pay a single cent unless you drive across. Right, you don't have to pay a single, any entrance fees to this. There's a lot of strategies to attract birds. For those of you who are bird enthusiasts, the Brahmini kite, the lesser tree duck, collared kingfisher, scaly, rested munia. These were all taken, at least these two were taken on site. So the bird diversity has increased quite significantly through the ecology. Right, butterflies, my area of interest, all these four butterflies were taken at Gardens by the Bay. And I still have people asking me, Gardens by the Bay got butterflies, man? Right? If you go to the conservatories, of course not. But walk out on your side. There's a lot of biodiversity there. So there were biodiversity counts pre-construction, during construction, after construction. Right? And I believe Gardens by the Bay will do a report on this because it is measurable. The biodiversity is measurable before and after intervention in a biophilic design. We actually graphs that plot the species density and the individual density of butterflies, dragonflies, and birds before, after, tracking over years. This stopped at 2014. I will steal the thunder from the people who are going to publish the paper because they've tracked the numbers still today. So even biophilic design can be measured as far as biodiversity is concerned. Okay, I will move to an area of my personal interest. Okay, and share some anecdotes that I face during the times when we implement projects. What are the challenges? What are the issues? I think one or two of you asked the questions. Our human expectation of nature is that we want nature to be under our control. And architects want the plants to look exactly like that. Right, no pruning, no growing in the building. And we have to temper our expectation of what the natural systems are. The key aspect, which I know the visual connection in biophilic design matters as long as you can see greenery, right, the benefits of biophilia, which our professors have mentioned. But to me, let's break that visual connection and get out into nature as well. Right? Don't look and enjoy nature through a piece of glass. The reason I say that because recently I encountered a cyber neurologist, psychologist, or I don't know what he calls himself, who said that by 2020 I can pull you into a box with high definition LCD monitors for the ceiling, and I can make you feel that you're anywhere in the world. Three dimensional, can make you feel green, I can make you smell the sea, all digitally created. And I think it is possible. If you go to some of these theme parks and all that, you begin to fool your mind. Right, you can extract all the benefits of biophilia in a box 60 meters in under the ground. What would happen to our nature if that scenario happens in 2020? Do you agree with me that these technologies can make it happen? Because it's your mind, it's a psychological benefit they fill your mind with digital creations. So to me, nature out there has to survive, and we need to get more people out there. Not to appreciate nature from behind in a safe environment. Appreciate nature as it is, in all its untidiness and messiness and even occasional dangers. And we have selective preferences as well. I tried that on a client, a lady client who I know would feel more comfortable in Orchard Road than out in the nature itself. But she says, I'm a believer in biodiversity at this point. I want more greenery and more biodiversity in my project. I said, let me test you. Take a look at this image. What does it evoke? Butterflies. Fine, I want more butterflies in my projects. Can you ensure that I have butterflies? Birds. Wonderful. Let's have more birds in our projects. What's this? Dragonfly. What does it do? Dragonflies, they eat mosquito larvae. Okay, great. Let's have more dragonflies in my project as well. Eats, what is this? Does it hurt you? Is it, no, that's a carpenter bee. Oh, bees are unacceptable. I don't want bees in my project. They sting people. Okay. This is to make Joseph happy. You got to be joking. A spider, that looks poisonous. Right? When you're talking about biodiversity, what do you start to, how do you start to define? You're selecting what you want in from nature and then excluding those things that you don't want. How do you do that? Spiders are not okay. And then it kind of like, oh, this one makes my skin crawl, I'm not going to have anything of this biodiversity in my project. So to illustrate a point, I think there's a wide variety of acceptance. Right? We have always been talking about birds and butterflies, but what happened to the other creatures? I haven't even begun to scratch the surfaces. The people who studies ants, millipedes, grasshoppers. Nature is wild. Biodiversity is wild. And then, okay, I showed her a picture of a butterfly and said, yeah, this is something I would definitely like to have. But can you stand this? It's going to eat your plants. Right? And then she said, can we get rid of this? Yeah, but you want this, right? So after a while, you know, she got my point that biodiversity appreciation is not selective. That's the caterpillar. For those of us who study butterflies, it's quite nice, rubbery spines. Don't mind it walking along my hands. So sometimes I wonder if when we talk about biophilic design, interaction with nature, are Singaporeans ready for it? As a generation, I think someone earlier mentioned that it has been brought up in a broader clinical and protected environment. We need to get out there again. And then there's this innate fear of biodiversity. Right, recently, I was in Pasir Ris Park Butterfly Garden and somebody saw a snake. Lady with a kid and said, can you get someone from MParks to beat the heck out of this guy because he's threatening me? He said, it's a oriental whip snake. So, I don't care what snake, if all snakes are poisonous, let's kill them. So there's this innate fear of certain products of biodiversity that we can. And again, like I said, you can't select, you can't decide what can or cannot be in your nature areas. And then the very famous story is about human-monkey interface in Singapore, or technically correct, to be technically correct, but the long tail macaque. You'll see a lot of these signs all around our parks, nature areas, do not feed the monkeys. In fact, I think Singapore is the only country in the world which has billboard signs reminders, 6 meters by 2 meters. Right, those of you who have been into the nature near MacRitchie and Ears Reservoirs. Big billboards do not feed the monkeys. National Park box rangers goes around telling people do not feed the monkeys. What happens? People still feed the monkeys. Right? Because they're furry, they look hungry, they're chubby, let's feed the monkeys. When this guy flashes his dental work at you, right? It is not so chubby anymore. Why? Because you modified the behavior of the monkeys. The monkey ecologists around that tell you they are not dependent on human diet, human fat diet. Right? That interface has become confrontational. Right? A mother with a kid looking at the face of this monkey will say, this furry animal is terrorizing me. Again, can you get NParks, Acres, whoever it is, get rid of it. This is the product of that human and biodiversity interface. Are there solutions? Right, we have to educate ourselves that nature is sometimes messy, unpredictable. We should create in our designs a layered effect that we're taking, like for the infants in biodiversity appreciation or nature appreciation, let's give them a safe environment first. Layer it with a wilder area and then an absolutely wild area. Temper that expectation, and then along the way, education is very much a part of Singapore today that we need to educate both the young and that generation that grew up in the developing years of Singapore, living in high-rise flats, indoor environments, no gardens, and forgotten what nature is. There's this famous story many years ago in South Wales, you have heard that a primary school teacher asked one of the kids of the class to draw a picture of a chicken, and she got a picture of a frozen chicken from cold storage. Why? Because do you see chickens running around? One of them in the 1970s and 1980s. Today, yes, NParks has informed me that the red jungle fowl is running all over the place. Okay, so people do see chickens. So education, engagement, right? This little picture shows a little butterfly enclosure that we were experimenting with. And I saw a primary school, primary four girl screaming and running out of this enclosure because she was terrified of butterflies. Okay, what could be more harmless than butterflies, but you know it's there. And then create the experiential journey. How many of you had a butterfly walk on your finger before? How does it feel? Right? So it's part of that experiential journey. Some people from the Herpetological Society that was just recently formed ask the members, or at least the members of the public, to hold a snake. Not many would dare hold a snake. But that's part of the experience and learning about nature. And we need to calibrate our expectations of what we deem nature should be. That in the light of biophilic design, introducing nature to our building projects, right? The part of living next to nature. So what next in biophilic design? I hope to see more efforts on habitat and ecosystem restoration in our building projects. Parks. I think NParks is already doing a fantastic job of creating biodiversity reintegration programs, species recovery programs for the areas under NParks. For the architects in practice, where the buildings where we need to be able to do that integration. Like someone mentioned in the morning session, what about companies? What about the CSR? Like they are part of that biophilic experience as well. Community engagement is very, very much important. The last one, management strategies, and this the next one will be the last slide. In Kutipot Hospital, right, after we managed to attract lots of birds and butterflies and everything into the hospital, the courtyard, people could see birds, And one of the maintenance people came up to see me and says, since you know so much about the ecology, can you find me birds that don't poo all over the place? This is a hospital, we can't have bird crapping all over our windows and everything. And then they went on to say that, well, maybe you can't do that. Can you select a species of birds that don't poo so much? Okay. And I thought it was amusing at first, but actually, maybe it could be done. Maybe you could attract specific birds, at least for an introduction. And the same applies for butterflies, right? You have the lady who says, I want to see butterflies, but can you get rid of the caterpillars? Right? So in one of our design strategies that I shared with M Parks in the Parks program, Park Connector and Nature Ways, right, introduce pathways where the general public walk, have the flowering plants, the nectaring plants next to it. Then where with the butterflies fluttering around them. Keep the caterpillar host plants further away, not so accessible, so that they don't encounter the caterpillars and the eaten up plants. Right? So conceptual strategy, but you can have your cake and eat it. Means introduce the general public that, yeah, you see the butterflies, you don't see the caterpillars, theoretically. Because the caterpillars are further away and in a maintenance zone. Okay, so that's part of my sharing, both as an architect and an ecologist and a nature lover. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Q. Last but not least, we have Professor Tay Kheng Soon. Professor Tay is a practicing architect and adjunct professor at National University of Singapore's School of Architecture. He was president of the Singapore Institute of Architects and founding member and chairman of the Singapore Planning and Urban Research. Professor Tay's civic activities include being a member of the advisory panel of the Government Parliamentary Committee on National Development, and a member of the advisory panel of the Singapore Institute of Policy Studies. Professor Tay, the floor is yours.
Hi, everybody. There must be some reason why I'm put that as the last speaker. Many of my practicing architects friends say that I'm actually a philosopher pretending to be an architect. And many of my academic friends say that I'm a practicing architect pretending to be a philosopher. So I shall try to be a philosopher tonight, today. A cautionary tale first. I don't know how many of you are aware of the epic of Gilgamesh. Gilgamesh was the king of a city in the Mesopotamian area, and that area was the beginning of human urbanization. He had a great admiration for a character, a natural man who lived in the forest. And this natural man, his name was Enkidu, who lived with the animals. He ate like an animal, he behaved like an animal, but he was a human being, and he was extremely strong. And Gilgamesh was very keen to seek out his friendship and to invite him to the city. Many times he invited him, but Enkidu refused. Finally, Enkidu was seduced by the most pretty girl which the king sent to the forest, and he was then induced to come to the city. And they became very good friends, and they became buddies throughout life. But it's significant to know that the two of them then decided to go to Lebanon to cut down all the forests. So here is a cautionary tale that the natural man, given the seduction of the city, right, has become part of the humanization of nature, shall I say? Okay, so that's the starting point. This morning's discussion ended with a question about trade-offs. I think the question poses a very serious challenge as to how should human beings live on planet Earth so that there is the minimum amount of trade-off. Okay? Okay, butterflies is great, but we don't want the caterpillars. So I'm going to say that I take a position for this discussion as a comprehensivist. So the comprehensivist view of biophilia is what I want to talk about. Okay. So let's look at the world first. The biophilic world requires a new development theory. Right now, the development theory is urbanization is inevitable and in fact desirable. And the kind of urbanization is the kind you see on this satellite picture, right? The spread of cities all over the world, and the light is wonderful, but the spread is awful. So, how do we return the Earth, how do we regard Earth as body and city as brain? And the world as a whole as the embodied mind? Now that's a totally different perspective from the kind of trade-off that we think about the problem of city and biophilia. So the existing urban planning methodology is something which I critique seriously because it acts like a cancer that has metastasized all over the world, driven by the greed of the rich, the desperation of the poor, and the insecurity of the middle class. That is why we have cities. So biophilia is the next stage. It is an important new way of thinking, right? But we are in danger of anthropomorphizing biophilia. We want to make nature, we want to humanize nature, okay? And in the thinking about it, particularly given the current economic stagnation, which is the, some people say is the final stage of neoliberal capitalism. And the city as we know it is a product of neoliberal capitalism, particularly in the late 19th century and 20th century and now. So what we have is actually technophilia. In other words, we can solve everything by technology, right? So how do we move out from technophilia to biophilia? That is the question which I think we need to ask. And to ask this question is requires a certain radicality, which I am rather concerned that the nature lovers are not prepared to be very radical. To be radical, you have to question the nature of the economy. You have to conceive of a shift or a rebalancing between the mechanized economy, which is the current economy, and the humanized economy. Minimum wage is just a small symptom of the issue of the humanized economy. Okay? What does it mean? What does a humanized economy really mean? And that's a question which I will not have time to develop here, but it is a question which I want to leave with you. In pursuing this question of the new development paradigm, we therefore need a new planning concept. By planning, I mean not only physical planning, but economic planning and social planning. And in terms of the physical planning, we need a new methodology. So I'm going to critique the existing urban planning methodology very seriously, particularly since this symposium is a collaboration between the nature, the NParks people, and Center for Livable Cities, which is a offshoot from the Urban Redevelopment Authority, okay, in whose charge is the issue of urbanization. So let me just straight away deconstruct the existing planning methodology. As a preface, I would just simply say that I had an interesting discussion with the chief land use planner for the European Union, and I asked this simple question. Do you have in your database, do you have a floor space census? That means, do you know what is the total amount of residential floor space, industrial floor space, office floor space, shopping floor space, every kind of floor space do you have? She kind of looked very puzzled and says, maybe Germany. Okay. I also asked my planning friends in Singapore, do you have floor space sensors? No. Alright, so this is a methodological flaw. So let's start by estimating what each person needs. Because in Singapore, most people live in HDB flats. And let's take an average of 4 people per HDB flat, 3 adults, I mean 2 adults and the children or something like that. You must include the Filipino maid as well. Because everybody occupies floor space. Okay? So if you add the total residential floor space together, and you add all the non-residential floor space together, you get a figure of about 50 square meters per person. Okay? But I was a bit puzzled by this, shocked by this figure. So I trawled the internet to check whether there are comparable figures. The only one I could find was Fairfax County, Washington, D.C. Any of you from Fairfax? Okay. They published their statistics on the non-residential floor space. So it's available on the net, you can check it out. I aggregated all the floor space and it worked out to 25 square meters per person. Okay. Now the flaw in planning method, physical planning methodology is the planners used typology, building types, and building types as models by which they model the amount of land required. Right? What they should do is, in high functioning economies like Fairfax County, which has got 2 aerospace industries, lots of government offices, George Mason University and so on. So it's a high functioning economy. High functioning economies will typically have a greater amount of floor space per person. Of course, if you were to measure the floor space per capita, say of Colombo in Sri Lanka, it will be a lot less than 50, right? So Singapore is 50. So I feel confident that we are not far off. Now, the question that has been seriously debated in Singapore is, what are we going to do with the kind of congestion in Singapore if we increase the population to 7 million from the current 5.4, okay, or 6.9 million? Everybody is very worried that, you know, the congestion will be impossible, etc., etc. Okay, here's the maths. So 7 million people times 50 square meters per person will produce 350 million square meters. If every building is 4 stories, which is a mathematical modeling, you will get 87,500,000 square meters, right? You divide that by the total land area of Singapore, the total surface area, including the rivers and the lakes and the parks and natural reserves, everything, everything. It's 720 million square meters. And that's only 12% of the land. 12% of the footprint is only 12%. And yet we say that we are short of land. And yet most of our buildings are, you know, 15, 20, 25 stories, averagely. Something's gone wrong. If every building, just simple math, mental maths, if every building is 8 stories, we only cover 6% of the land. If every building is 16 stories, we will cover what? 3% of the land. In other words, there's no land problem. Something's gone wrong, right? Somebody is bluffing or somebody is fudging. So what is happening is there's a methodological problem, a disciplinary problem. Architects think only of individual buildings, at best maybe a street, urban design. Planners look at land and look at allocation, right? They basically think 2D, architects think 3D. You need a new discipline in between, which is architect-planner or planner-architect, who can correlate three-dimensional properties of space allocation in relation to 2D land allocation. And it's very simple. If you did that, since you assume that Singapore should be, is, and should continue to be a high-functioning economy, then you should expect that our per capita floor space will have to be 50 square meters, or even more, or slightly less. Okay. So if you multiply the total amount of populations in relation to it, by that you will get the total, you will get the total bulk of buildings, right? So since you know the total bulk, you just have to slice it up this way or this way and distribute it. So very simple. If you decide to put a lot here, because you know the total quantum, because if you put a lot here, it means you need to put a lot less there. Right? And if you put less there, you can put even less there. And so on. In other words, you have a three-dimensional model of how the space is how space, three-dimensional space should be deployed, and how and what would be the impact on the landscape. So if you say, oh, we should have more green paths, we should have more coastal mangroves, we should have more riverine landscapes, we should preserve historic areas. Of course you can do all that. If you know how to deploy your floor space. But unfortunately, our architects and planners have not collaborated sufficiently in order to produce those answers which you need in advance. So that's my critique of the physical planning. Now my critique of the spatial planning, the human dimensions of spatial planning. The current model of spatial planning is narrow, right? So the favorite word that is used is hub in a way. The important conceptual shift that we must learn from nature is everything is network, right? The brain itself is an elaborate network system, right? 100 billion neurons, right? Each one with 10,000 axons, right? Which means that the connectivity and the interoperability and interaction between the components are enormous. Let's think of how we can turn the whole island into a brain. That's the question. And that means looking at the urban pattern as a nervous system. So, what we need to do? We need to insert a central nervous system into every housing estate, which means that all the important social functional areas, schools, shops, working places, offices, civic functions, cultural facilities, all should be network together into an elaborate web and not nodes, right? Once you have nodes, it means you have aggregation, you have congestion, therefore you have clotting, you have thrombosis, okay? So this is the planning methodology that is universally adopted all over the world. And this is disastrous. So, turn the whole island into a brain, starting by inserting nervous systems into our existing housing estates. Okay? So, turn every housing estate into a campus. So, brain functions are important. Okay? This is a project which I did with my students in one of the housing estates, right? How do you insert the central nervous system into an existing situation? It's not easy, because the existing situation is mobile. Right, it's clotting. How do you break that? Because there are real estate issues, there are land issues, there are vested interests, and so on. Okay, but this is worth thinking about. Right, so the rest is actually practical problems. Okay, let me just give you an illustration of the planning methodology, the mathematics of it, applied to the southern area of Singapore. I need to get my pointer. this lot here identifies all the available land in the southern area. Stretching from Pandan Valley, Pandan Reservoir over to the school park. Okay, so we identify all the pieces of land here, and so we know the total floor area. And if we apply 50 square meters per person, we will know the total density is 4.5. Floor area ratio of 4.5. No big deal. All right. So this is what it looks like. In other words, if we were to intensify in the south like this, we don't need to touch any of the existing land, all the nature reserves, all the riverine areas, all the heritage areas, all can be preserved. Why are we not having the dialogue? Because there's vested interest. Okay? So in order to overcome vested interest, we elect politicians, right? So unless the politicians are part of vested interest. All right. So this is a project which I'm now working with my students. We are looking at the whole of NUS campus. These are the existing buildings. What a mess. The existing campus was designed in the 60s in order to prevent student agitation. So that all the students will have to be separated. So there's not a lot of mix. There's no squares, no places where they can meet. So it's a dead campus. Time's up. Good God. So many more slides. Okay, so the blue part is where we're going to put a big bicycle track right around the campus. Because right now it's an unusable campus from the pedestrian point of view. So if we can link it all up, and if we can put 200,000 people to live in the campus, we can turn the campus into a city and therefore become a brain. Okay. So far we are thinking about the cities. And I think the basic assumption is in the discussion is a middle class assumption. Okay? We are the middle class. So we think city, right? But what about the countryside? We did studies of slum areas in Jakarta, in the Pasig River, in Manila and so on. It is very clear. The failure of the slums that circle every major city in Asia is because of the failure of the countryside. So people are moving in. So what is the solution? What is the biophilic solution to the problem of human degradation? Okay? Human beings are also part of nature. Why are we ignoring that in biophilia? So the notion of rural urbanization. This Friday, I'm invited to go to India, I'm there for a week, to participate in a workshop on urbanization in the central area of India. How do we solve the problem of rural degradation? This is the seminar. Then the human being, the changing of the human being. These are the students that built the tree house. So right now on Facebook, I have, together with a lot of people, promoting the idea of building tree houses in Singapore. Right, so that with the building of each tree house, we built democracy in Singapore, one tree house at a time. And this is in Johor, I can't do it in Singapore yet. Okay, so then coming back to the city, what kind of city? What is the future of urbanization? I agree urbanization is necessary because it offers human opportunities, it offers information, it offers networking, it offers a lot of possibilities. But what kind of city? Right? Because right now, the kind of city is simply more and more aggregation. So there are renewal strategies, there are adaptive strategies, there are infiltration strategies and so on. But they are not addressing the fundamental question, and which is what kind of city? Okay? So the concept of modular city, go to YouTube and you can key in my name and you will get modular city. We have a 17-minute video of it. Okay, this is a project which we developed with my students. Right, you will notice that there are so I got my students to use a go on Google Earth and select parts of cities that they love. So they selected Athens, some selected Barcelona, some selected Florence, some selected Kaohsiung, another one selected Macau, a certain part of Macau, one selected Havana. So we just take it, transplant it, right? And we computed the 4-area ratio, right? So the 4-area ratio worked out to be 3.5, right? So if it's 3.5, and the average height of the buildings are only about 6 stories, 3 to 6 stories. And if we increase the 4-to-4 height to 5 meters, it means we can slot in another level in between, right? And allow for vertical spaces and so on. So there are a lot more architectural interventions possible within the fabric of the building and within the fabric of the city. Okay? So, what kind of economy? The central part is where the factories are. And ultimately, the logic of factory production is robotic factories. Right? So which means that human labor is greatly reduced. Then we're going to do the human beings, right? The humanized economy. Right? All the stuff that machines cannot do or should not do should be done by human beings. And human beings should be paid a lot more than they are paid now. Why? Because if they are not paid, total aggregate demand decreases as in the current global economy, and therefore economy stagnates. It is smart for the rich guy who owns a factory to make sure that his customer can afford to buy his stuff. In other words, the rich entrepreneur must develop the human resource in order to buy his production. That's the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Tui.
So, this is the modular city, right? So you add a few modular cities, you can make an aggregate area of maybe a million people or 2 million people, right? And it's always surrounded by farms, and nature and whatever you want. Okay. So we propose that we build the first one in Singapore, right? And I want to say this. I'm very grateful that Singapore has been so successful and is well noted in the world. But I want to say further, for those who have achieved a lot, more is expected of them. So this is what they should do. And it should be like this. This is the future, okay? And if you look at Singapore, this is 7 million people with that green space.
Well, thank you once again, Professor Tay. Our next segment is the Genetic Panel Discussion, which will be processed for publication in the January 2016 issue of Urban Solutions, which is the biannual magazine of the Center for Livable Cities. Now, this January 2016 issue will focus on building with nature and will be freely available for download on the CLC website when published. Now, for this panel discussion, may I now invite Professor Kellett, Professor Beatley, Professor Newman, Dr. Lina Chan, Mr. Q, and Professor Taylor to take their seats on stage. This next session will be moderated by Dr. Lee Min Hee, the Director of Research from the Center of Livable Cities. This next segment will be a discussion among the panel members on themes and set questions from the organizers. So we will not be accepting questions from the floor during this thematic panel discussion. However, only after the panel discussion, we will then open the session for another round of Q&A, if there's time. So I'll now hand over the next segment to Dr. Lee Min Hee to moderate this panel discussion. Dr. Hee, please.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon. We have reached the last segment of our program today. We are about like 1 hour later than originally scheduled, so I would try to urge our panelists also to keep their answers short for this segment. You had your session early on. We have a good mix of professors and practitioners in this segment, and it's going to be a lively discussion, and we hope to cover some ground here and to allow time for a good Q&A later. May I just very quickly reiterate some of the approaches to the idea of biophilia and the city that we have heard today, starting with Kenneth and the idea of loving nature as a very basic concept. Professor Kalliot had shared with us on the need for a paradigm shift in how we design and build buildings, and about the inherent need for us to affiliate with and connect with nature. Professor Bitney has shared with us about the idea of putting nature at the core of design and planning for the city and not an afterthought, and that there's no perfect example of biophilic cities, but he showed us a whole variety of approaches which work very well. Professor Newman have talked about the use of biophilic cities as a new and disruptive technology, and we can no longer get by just having traditional landscaping between buildings, and especially for dense buildings, there's a need to be more precise about quantifying and about thinking about the economies of such an approach. Dr. Mina Chan had shared with us that Singapore is indeed a very biodiverse city, and about NPARC's efforts to indeed bring nature closer to people. Q has shared with us his ideas that he has derived through practice and his own personal interest about the human biodiversity in this interface, and how we may have to need to educate citizens to live with nature. And of course, Kim Soon freshly finished talking about the idea of a radically new planning concept approach for true biophilic city, thinking of the earth as a body and the city as a mind. And I think all these approaches are very, very interesting and very, very radically different in some ways. So I'd like to start the session off by talking about something that I heard from Peter Edwards, who is an ecologist and director of the Future Cities Lab, who shared with us that we can learn a lot from the rainforest, and that it is a system that can persist if it's in balance with its environments. But cities are presently conceived as being severely out of balance, and this has to change. So may I invite Tim, Peter and Kim Soon to help elaborate on how an ecological and urban systems can be integrated through the approaches that you have been exploring. So Tim, can I start with you?
I'll reiterate some of the things I've already said about biophilic cities. For me, there are places that put nature at the core of everything, which is profoundly about balance. It's about recognizing that a meaningful life is one lived with contact, daily contact with birds and insects and trees and things in nature. And my notion of biophilic city is also one that connects, I think, with what Peter Newman and others have talked about in terms of the metabolism of a city, and recognizing that support for the kind of consumption of urbanites has a huge impact on nature globally. And so my notion of biophilic city is also a city that thinks about and cares about those impacts perhaps hundreds of miles away. So I'm starting to think about this blue urbanism idea. How can we enlist cities in support of marine conservation? It's marine conservation, marine areas around cities, but perhaps ocean environments that are many hundreds of kilometers away from that city. That it's all about balance in a way, and readjusting the sort of metabolism of cities to give nature a kind of more central
importance there.
And Peter?
What can I add new after what we've been saying over and over? It's I think there is a tendency to believe that nature can be romanticized and that we can live like hunter-gatherers once did. I remember hearing the economist Kenneth Boulding say, "The door to the Garden of Eden has slammed shut and there's no way forward but Zion." The story of the Garden of Eden is actually about our role as hunter-gatherers, where we lived in total contact with nature, and it was in harmony and fully integrated. And the choice was made to eat the apple of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It is actually about choosing opportunity that cities provide. It is all about knowledge. It is all about what you can do. And of course, as soon as we leave that behind us, we not only use science to make beautiful objects that can help our cities function, we also make bombs that blow them up and motor vehicles that destroy them. And there is always the knowledge of good and evil. So we know, but we keep choosing that. So the way forward is Zion, which the Zion picture in the Bible is, in my view, the image we should have. That it is a city. It's a city that, you know, that in Revelation it talks about the city coming down from heaven. It is a city that is made of jewels and gold and has a tree of life and a river of life running through the middle of it. It is a city, still a city, but it has these natural components as a, you know, absolutely central to it. So we don't need to romanticize nature. We need to make it, build it in. Now, the way that Stephen is constantly showing these buildings that are beautiful and attractive because they are actually building nature into it in terms of the light and the structure of the materials and the whole presence of nature, as well as the fact that we have links to butterflies and birds and all of that the beauty of nature provides. But I don't think we romanticize it to say it's kind of like our own little zoo.
And the idea of the apple and for eating it, you know, requires that you have the knowledge to deal with living in cities. It's a good sign for King Soon to, and your chance to talk more.
The questions are, at this stage of human history, given the global financial crisis, which is not going to go away, any discussion, I think, about biophilia and quality of life, etc., has to address that question. I'm afraid that all the good feelings that we share today are not good enough. That's a problem. Let me give you a few, some mental arithmetic to do. Sorry. The total arable land on planet Earth, including pasture land, is 49 million square kilometers. That means it's seven, if you visualize it as a square, it is 7,000 kilometers by 7,000 kilometers. various leaders in the world. Okay? If we say that, and if we ask the question, knowledge for who? Cities for who? Nature for who? We must address the question of social justice, right? So, there are 3 billion people living in the abject poverty in the countryside. There's 1 billion or more living in slums all around the major cities in Asia. India, China, Indonesia, Latin America, Africa, right? Even the United States. So the question of justice for who is has to be asked if you talk about nature, right? So if you calculate, if you base on, say, absurdly 50 square meters per person, everybody must live like Singaporeans, okay? And you say 50 times 4 billion people, because 3 billion are middle class and well-heeled like us, okay? We will continue to live in cities like Singapore, right? In the salubrious areas of Makati or Bangkok or Shanghai or wherever. We are okay. And we love nature. Then what would the footprint be of these 4 billion people? If we use the modular city model which I propose, which is absolutely luxurious. Okay? 4 billion people will be housed in 40,000 modular cities. That means 40,000 square kilometers, because each city is 1 kilometer square, right? For mathematical, easy calculation. Square root of 40,000 is 200 kilometers by 200 kilometers. It is a dot in this huge green square, isn't it? In other words, the possibility of achieving social justice and environmental justice is entirely possible. Why are we doing it? That's the question. That is the question we must ask ourselves.
I think on that note, I would like to go on to the next question. I think we will try to do the math while we ask Steve to share a little bit about the ideas of his book, Biophilic Design and the Theory, Science and Practice of Brain Buildings to Life, where you describe a very positive experience of natural systems and processes which are critical to human health and performance. And perhaps I would invite for this question for Stephen and Q to share on instances of design which actually managed to achieve these kinds of ideas.
I'm confronted with the dilemma that we all are. What can we say that we haven't said already? and be extremely dependent. I'd rather not. We'll talk about it later. I'm going to be extremely mundane by comparison. In a practical consideration, I do think that one of the challenges of, and there are examples, and I think that we do have some good case studies, some of which I shared with you earlier, of benefits that have been identified and measured in a variety of spheres, education, health, and residential environments, community environments, work, et cetera, where there's demonstrable benefits that are associated with enhanced contact with nature that do provide some models and some opportunities. My biggest concern is that, which goes to the heart of what we mean by biophilic design, is that in some ways we, is biophilic design something different? Or is it just another kind of fancy name that we've picked up for saying nature? And is a, if anything, any expression of nature in the built environment is biophilic, then why are we using the term? It's just a more confusing term for a term that's already pretty confusing, which is, what is nature? And so we need to ask ourselves, what is it that we're proposing that it that is demonstrably different, that provides a methodology and a direction, both technically and philosophically, forward in how we design our built spaces, and most particularly urban. And I think there's a number of considerations that we need to think about before we simply think use it as another term for nature. One that I think is coming up today repeatedly is, this is something that you said before, is connectedness and networking. I mean, fundamentally, biophilic design is ecological. It's not simply a putting a plant here or a picture there or of nature or natural material over there. If we're not creating a habitat, an ecosystem, with, again, mutually complementary parts that together comprise a whole that's greater than the sum of its individual inputs, then we haven't really done anything that's, in my estimation, biophilic, because fundamentally we're talking about, I said before, designing good habitat for people as a biological organism, which means creating an ecosystem. Another is that it needs to be experiential. It needs to be deeply engaging. It needs to, it can't be, as I think we have a picture of nature through the window. That's not engaging. That's not experiential. That's vicarious. It's removed. It's dispassionate. And that gets to a third E. These are all going to be E's. It needs to be emotional. In order to identify with and take responsibility for our places, we need to be deeply connected to them, and that is fundamentally an emotional consideration. Now, the cognitive and intellectual construct will follow because we're motivated, but the emotional engagement is fundamental to the whole notion of biophilic. It needs to be evolutionary. That is, it needs to be consistent with our biology as an organism and how we've evolved and adapted response to natural forces and stimuli, and recognizing those aspects of our connection to the natural world as a species with a particular niche on the ladder of life that has responded to particular aspects of the natural world which have conferred survival and fitness. And if it doesn't relate to that, it's not biophilic. And then finally, ran out of ease, but it needs to be, I'll call it value. That is, we need to recognize it needs to resonate with the human experience on a multiplicity of levels. When we saw that picture of, I never pronounce it, the hospital. Hospital. It wasn't simply an aesthetic experience. There were growing things on the earth. We need to recognize there's a multiplicity of relationships that people deeply depend upon and are inherently inclined to express that are not just simply loving nature. Biophilia is not loving nature. It's affiliated with nature. And it involves emotional attachments of various sorts. It involves attraction to aesthetic qualities. Also involves aspects of utilization, control, and fear and aversion. That fear is an important motivator. When the remark was made that we need to recognize that we'll never experience nature vicariously in the same way we do experientially in person, that's because there's an element of aversion and adaptive response and coping and challenging, which is just as much a part of a deep experiential engagement as enjoying a beautiful scene. And the more, the deeper the levels of connection and relationship, the deeper the level of respect and affiliation and moral responsibility that will emerge from that. So all these are elements of what we mean by biophilia that need to be recognized and understood and incorporated so that it just doesn't become a new fancy obscure term for describing any gesture towards human nature to into the world.
I think that's very beautifully said. How you develop the relationship with nature, and I think that's actually a good sign for me to like you to talk about, his experience personally and as a professional.
I'll bring it down to a building level, in terms of biophilic design and in the healthcare pathology. After Kutekwa Hospital, we asked ourselves, how do we move to the next level? I mean, Kutekwa Hospital, it's biophilic, there's a lot of considerations given to the healing environment. And we were participating in the next hospital. Last Saturday, we had the opening by our Prime Minister, the Ng Keng Fong General Hospital. And we looked at the micro designs, adopting biophilic principles, looking at a micro design of a typical ward, typical six-bedder ward. Okay, I think most of you would have visited a hospital before, right? Only two patients get to benefit the window view. The other four, in a rectilinear layout, are removed from the window. Okay, in the painting form design, we reinvented that ward design. Use a herringbone layout. And then went and saw the idea as every patient has a window. In a public survey, everybody loved it. And we asked ourselves why. What's in it for you as a patient just to get a window? What's the hang up about a window? Right? It's the view that, in terms of biophilic design, it's the view that you have control of. And each person appreciates that the connectivity with the outside, right? And we have landscaping outside, right? That fires up the imagination of that statement, every patient has a window. So the people who loved it is actually responding to a biophilic strategy. That even at the window, I can imagine looking out at the trees, hearing the birds, opening my window and smelling the air after the haze is over. And having that control over your personal well-being through a window. It was that simple micro design based on biophilic principles, and it kind of won the day from us. Because if you have an opportunity, go visit Ng Keng Fong General Hospital. And that's a very different biophilic approach from Kutekwa, which is in a more remote area, the small land around it. And Keng Fong is in a very built-up area. And that aspect of biophilic design still comes through in that little gesture at a micro design.
I'm going to move on to the next question. The Mayor of St. Louis once said when he opened his butterfly garden in the city that citizens might live in a city where they would see and experience butterflies. A city shouldn't be a place with gardens you have to walk to or a park that's 15 minutes away. Our vision is that you are living in a park. Nature is all around you. It's not something you have to go and visit. So this is a good point for me to invite Lina to share with us in how this concept of city in the garden has moved forward in the Singapore context and how it has become more of a social and community kind of idea here?
Okay, I think the first thing I would like to maybe share with you is that in the city in the garden, we had several thrusts. And one of them is actually infused biodiversity into an urban setting, because we know that biodiversity is in the forest, you know, in the natural environment. But the key thing is, the challenge is, how do you actually infuse biodiversity in an urban setting? So that was our task. And so I'm not sure how many of you know that there is actually a butterfly walk right from opposite Tanglin Shopping Mall, right up to Fort Canning. So you walk along Orchard Road, talking about, you know, some side road, you know, in the middle of nowhere, right? Orchard Road is a butterfly walk. And you can also hear a lot of birds along the way, yeah, especially in the evenings. Then the other thing is, if you go along many of our highways, expressways, Mandai Road, Tampines Expressway, you actually see bursts of butterflies at times. Flying across. So, in that sense, you don't. We are trying very hard to cater to all ages too, right from the young, because the young kids are not going to. They have to wait for, you know, the parents to come back and bring them over the weekend, whatever. No, why don't we just create that opportunity? The, you know, how should I put it? They are able to. Go to a park on their own if it's just about 100 or 200 meters away. So in Singapore, the planning is such that many of the housing estates, residential areas, have not big parks. We do have regional parks, we do have parks, but we also have what we call it neighborhood parks and playgrounds. And they're all very, very close by, so they can just, kids can just go, parents should be quite safe to let the kids go. And with an aging population, you're not going to walk for miles or travel miles to actually go to a park. So again, there is actually a target in our sustainability master plan blueprint that by 2030 we should actually be able to, I think 90% of the population is within, like, I think it keeps changing, but if I'm not mistaken, less than 400 meters away from the park. So on top of that, you notice too that please go and open your eyes a bit when you drive. And our streetscape too has changed its policy and what we plan. And it makes that of a forest, because in an urban environment, we have actually simplified the whole system, which is why it is not so sustainable as such. But the forest is more sustainable simply because there's this complexity, and therefore, you know, there is this interdependency. So how do we actually make sure that the urban ecosystems, buildings, have that complexity so that we can ensure sustainability and, you know, on its own? So those are the kind of things that we are trying to do in innovative ways. But we can't do it all just not in parts. I think you need you out there to actually come up with the ideas on how do we actually infuse this biodiversity into the urban setting, that's one. And two, as many of you too recognize, there is this human, you know, wildlife interaction, which some people take it as positive, some take it as negative. But I think it needs us to go, and it's a long journey, educating ourselves, educating other people. But again, unless you touch and feel and interact with nature, you're never going to, unless you know about it, you could easily fear it. So I think we need that kind of a direct experience as much as possible. As Tim said, what do we need? Is it daily dose? Is it hourly dose? Yes, I think every minute. I wish we had more plants in here, just a few plants. Yeah, and I think that's the thing. And we need to create it ourselves, because when you know the value, as Peter said, if you know the value of biodiversity, the benefits of biodiversity, and the so-called economic value, then we would make sure that, you know, we ensure biodiversity levels.
Hey, thank you so much. I think that would be a good segue for me to open the floor to the audience. Please tell us your name, where you're from, and keep your question short, like get to the question quickly. So,
hello, my name is Mr. Edward Pan. My question is direct to Mr. Kim. Just one question only. Is that just now he mentioned about the monkeys. Actually, it's not the humans want to give the monkeys. It's the monkeys not enough food. Because now all the developers and HDB, they can cut off the trees. The ecosystem has changed. So now the monkeys and the birds, they are not enough food. So they hope the humans can give them food. Because my area, the further developer cut off the trees and all the birds come to my side, and then they pick up the rubbish waste, and then they dirty my neighborhood. It's actually not enough food. It's not enough food. It's not enough food.
What's the question?
No, just now you mentioned about monkeys. He said the humans want to give the food to monkeys. It's not the humans want to give the monkeys themselves not enough food.
So Tim has the response.
I was going to say it before, but I think what you're getting at is that top-down approaches to this issue are not always going to work. It's always a bit more complicated. And I would hope that you are trying to produce a solution in there yourself, and that perhaps you would be doing something to help. In my street in Fremantle, we have a gorilla gardener. He has completely redone all the verges outside every house along the street. And this is not a normal Singapore type story, because this wouldn't be allowed. And it isn't allowed in Fremantle either, but he just does it. Because he wants to see more nature rather than just grass. And he's rebuilt the street as a rainforest. It's quite remarkable. Now, it does take more water to do this in a Mediterranean climate, but it is so much cooler and more attractive. People love to walk down our street now. And he's done this. The council, the Fremantle Council, just says, oh, well, you know, you can't stop it, so it just lets it happen. There is an element in which the bottom-up approaches are needed in this whole story, as well as having the brilliant Leonard Chan constructing the solutions. We need all of that. We need all the bottom-up solutions. We've now got parklets happening across our city. Parklets are little tiny parks that are being created by local people, and they can get a parking space allocated to this little park. And they had a crowdfunding competition to see the best ideas for these parklets, and the best three or four of them won and were given funding from various sources to enable it to be built. So there's ways, and in New York there's lots of examples of these little new parks being created on empty blocks, and then the council buys it and creates that as a more permanent feature. I think the bottom-up approach to this bringing nature back into the city has to be facilitated as much as possible.
If I could something that's very important and not very and frustrating, because bottom-up approaches are slow and difficult for planners and government officials, but ultimately the only truly sustainable approaches. Because the reality is that now Singapore is an exception. It's an exception because I think of your government and your scale and your geography, so to speak. architects are important, but most architects are hired hands. They do what 99% of the architects do what the developers tell them to do. There's a few architects who can perhaps be more engaged in the decision-making process, but most of them are not. And the developers, both the economics of development and the average value system and of the developers is such that it's a lot easier for them to clear a landscape and put up a bunch of boxes as quickly as possible and get a return on investment as quickly as possible for the investors who have no stake in the local economy, for the most part, in terms of large-scale urban development. And that is the reality. And so to change that reality, either you have to have an enlightened dictatorship, that says, we're going to have an eco-town, we're going to have all these things, we're going to modulate, you know, which may sound great on paper, but in the long run usually is a disaster for all sorts of reasons. Or you have to have a fundamental change in the value system of the population such that it demands a different kind of experience that drives development decisions. And that is difficult and slow. Nonetheless, you know, as I said before, we are a herd species. So you can get to a certain point where you can have change occur quite quickly, even though it seems very banal at first. And that's where the demonstration bodies, inspiration, models, innovation becomes very important. That's where Singapore can be extremely important as a model for others around the world. But it's going to take that kind of shift from the bottom up to change the development mentality and the economics of development to really affect a profound transformation.
Thank you, Steve. I
just want to make that point that in our conversation we have talked a lot about trade-offs and various concepts, but I think something that we probably can identify with more is that the reason why we would like biodiversity around us is because it makes our environment more livable. And that's, I think, very important. Livability, we want to live in a livable city. And sustainability, because with just pure concrete structures, it's not sustainable. It's going to be very expensive trying to maintain it. So, cooling of temperatures, you know, replenishing good air quality and all that, we need biodiversity. So for us, we come from a very functional viewpoint, how to make Singapore livable and sustainable.
Thank you. I see quite a few hands. I think we'll pick three questions first so that we can try to cover as much ground. So one, two. I thought I saw another hand. Yeah, three. Yes.
Hi, my name is Helena Hulsman from the Netherlands, from Del Taurus Water Research Institute. Too tall for this. More people in touch. I had a question for all of you. To implement biophilic design structures or applications, it requires a lot of different players. And some of them are more convinced of the added value of biophilia than others. And I was wondering what you regarded as the largest challenge, or which stakeholder group poses the largest challenge to attain a full a biophilic urban area. Thanks a lot.
Actually, I have two, but you can choose not to answer whatever they are. So, most of the discussion so far has been about new developments, new buildings, new parks, new constructions, perhaps even new political economic systems to introduce biophilia. So, my first question is, in so doing, are we sacrificing some sorts of biodiversity for others? For example, in the case of Gardens by the Bay, as much as introduce new species into the area, my first thought is also then, what about all the marine species that sacrifice in order to reclaim the land to build the gardens? The second question is then, what can we do about, short of building new biophilic buildings and environments and cities and all these things, what can we do about existing buildings, like perhaps for Dr. Liu Chen's consideration, schools and government buildings and other government institutions where there isn't a dedicated people to go and preserve the local biodiversity of these places. Because as Dr. Keller has said earlier, the point of biophilic buildings also is to build emotional attachments to the buildings. And if there is already an emotional attachment, then how can we act on these to improve existing infrastructure and buildings? Thank you.
Thank you. So let me just quickly reiterate the questions. What would we do if we have unlimited funds to make biophilic buildings? Number two, which is the biggest challenge in convincing which group of stakeholders about using this approach. Number three, what are the trade-offs in biodiversity that we have been making? And number four, what can we do about existing buildings which form a large part of our environment? So who would like to take any of these questions first?
I'm going to subvert the idea of having so much money and power that you can do anything. I've actually been in situations like that. I've worked with the Premier of our state three times, and when you get close to power, you realise it's not much there. The reality is they have money and they have the ability to do things, but they, in the end, are swayed by what people think. And so I feel that the greatest power lies with us as we come up with the ideas and projects that seed the future. They're not going to get out there with all their money and power and say, right, I am going to create this whole new city, perhaps, as our professor showed us. They're not going to do it because they will not get elected if you go that way. You will only be elected again if you're moving along with the public. So in my sense, the ability to come up with the next agenda that gets funded slowly and demonstrates and then brings the people with them, that's the most important thing to do. And it is exactly what we're trying to do in our PhDs. We've got 95 PhDs at the cusp. They're all seeding the future. We're all trying to come up with something that will actually push the agenda that next step forward. And certainly Singapore's been doing that on a global basis. And let me get a quick example. Marina by the Bay, which was mentioned there, it was not built as a biodiversity project. It was not built in order to replace those marine species by some new species that are brought in. It was built to solve a water problem and to enable the barrage to be built so that you could actually use, in a highly innovative way, the freshwater Singapore River as a source of water, and to demonstrate a closing of the loop metabolism that is extremely important for the world to see, that you can actually have cities that can drink the water from that is brought in into that area, rather than having to get it from large distances and bring it in from outside. It's a local water solution that is very innovative. And in the process, you had to bring along Gardens by the Bay and doing the other innovative biodiversity projects, if you like. And in many ways, that is going to be what happens for a lot of our projects. A lot of our biophilic innovations are going to happen as part of other things. And that's, we are living in a city with a whole series of complex projects, and let's jump in there and provide the option of putting a biophilic urbanism into the design of any new building, any new garden, any new space, and show that that is the next future thing to do. And if you can do that, I think you're going to change the world.
I'll just piggyback on that. I share the same skepticism about sort of higher level officials sometimes, but at the same time thinking about the experience of some of our of other leading cities that have made great strides. I'm thinking about places like Chicago. It's often the mayor, in fact, and I've mentioned several mayors in my presentation, and if you can reach that level and get the mayor excited about this idea, it may not have that much power, but they've clearly been able to make things work in lots of places. So I think that's a very strategically important level to aim at. And then, at least in the American scene, we often have a sort of a sustainability director or a mayor's office staff level, and often they are the ones that sort of get energized and go forward. So I wouldn't give up on the higher or not, I know, but often a lot can happen, and when you can reach that mayor, that can lead to a citywide policy or a program or something that's it's not just a pilot project, but something that's citywide and can have even greater impact. That said, what I was about to say to an earlier question, I was going to chime in support of the sort of grassroots approach. And if I had unlimited money, I suppose I would fund things at that level and fund the sort of social infrastructure there. And so much happens at that level, or could happen, and it's often about seeding things and providing support, little bits of support, a number of fantastic stories about just kind of getting out of the way. So San Francisco, you mentioned parklets, and San Francisco has kind of been innovating in that area. And they have neighborhoods where citizens have been trying to install sidewalk gardens, but there hasn't been a sidewalk garden permit. So there wasn't a sort of a legal mechanism for actually allowing them to do what they wanted to do. Well, it took some activism to get it done, and they changed their codes and basically got out of the way, made it possible for someone to actually take up the sidewalk and legally plant a garden. So I think there's lots of things that can happen if we think about how to empower that neighborhood level sort of activity.
Thank you for all that money they're going to give us. But I think, I don't think that's going to be sustainable, because once you give, say, so much money, then you could have do so much more and so much more, and then you'll ask for more. I don't think that's the way. Unless people believe in it and want it, and then they will think of ways of doing things. And when they want to do things, then they can then ask for specific funds rather than give you so much money. I think it's not sustainable when you just have a large sum of money and then try and think of projects to do. Then the other thing that young gentleman asked, which is very relevant, I think we can start small. So if you can't change the layout of your office or your room or whatever, then you can just start simple things like just planting plants around, making sure there are plants around in your workspace, office space. And it was interesting because we went to China, Shenzhen, and what happened was that it was this one-stop center, and it dealt with doing everything. And there were lots of people there who would come and complain and scream at the offices and all that. So what happened was every one of the offices had plants around them, and right in the middle of that building, there was this garden. And every time they felt stress, they just went into the garden and just relaxed. So the point that I'm trying to make is that we need space just right next to us, whether it is just looking out of our office window, right next to our desk, or in our bedroom, in our house, something that we can actually associate with nature. I know somebody too, this person left the windows open so that sunbirds can just fly through it. And what he did was just kept some plants, and the sunbirds would just fly in, hit the rain, and then after that fly out. So I think those are little things. How do we then determine, take control of our lives on introducing, infusing gardens into our lives?
I'm not quite sure. Well, I'm trying to kind of think about this issue of biophilia on a global scale. While it is valid to talk about plants on the windowsill and having nice little urban gardens and insertions into existing urban systems and all that, I can't help feeling that while that is valid, is it really arranging the chairs on the sinking Titanic? That's the issue. And I think the issue goes beyond, I think, Singapore. I think we've done well. We've achieved what we have done so far. And I think that Singapore is a good place to think beyond Singapore. And when you talk about that question about if you had everything, if you had all the resources, what would you do? I think the first thing that we need to do in Singapore is to think through the issue of biophilia globally. What is the systemic issue? How do we solve the issue of relationship between nature and human beings, between cities and countrysides, between rich and poor, between monoculture and biodiversity? All of these questions, they involve principles which are, some of which have been demonstrated in Singapore, but I think we can go beyond that. Let me give you an example of a question which the previous Secretary General of ASEAN said to me in a private discussion. The question that he posed to architects and planners is, what are you going to do with 400 million poor people in Southeast Asia? Because if you did not address that issue, you're going to have to face problems when they migrate and become refugees coming into Europe, for example, that kind of situation we are facing, right? How do you protect your borders? So the question then boils down to politics, as you have mentioned. City governments right now answer only to city populations. They don't bother about anything else. Take the case of Indonesia. The last general election was very instructive. Joko Widodo won because his voting base was from East Java. Primarily, countryside, small towns, small villages. They supported him and he became the president. His opposition are from West Java, where all the industries and big business and fat cats are all there, and they lost. But everybody expected that Jokowi would be able to change the development paradigm of Indonesia, particularly in Java, which is the central thing. He is being sabotaged and blackmailed every step of the way by the urban industrial elite. And you can see the results. The burning of the forest is a direct result of that. He dare not take serious action against the perpetrators of the fire because they are they control the purse, the money. They are the guys who pay for the big developers. So the question the question of biofilia, therefore, has to be globalized. It cannot be a Singapore issue. The haze is a clear case, right? Are we concerned about the development of Sumatra and Kalimantan? If we are not, because we're just looking at our own situation, then we're going to have to breed the fog and the mop and the haze that they generate. What do we do? Should we not, in our own interest, invest in the infrastructure development together with others in, from China or other places? Invest in the infrastructure to increase the livelihood of the rural poor in order that they will not do the things they are doing now. So the issue is it's complex, definitely. It is, the complexity goes beyond the biological field, right? It's a human issue, right? It's about the organization of power and resources, okay? So the question is, where is the money coming from? The lesson is quite simple. The lesson that we have learned from Mr. Ford, who started the Ford factory, right? Pay your workers well so that they can buy your cars, okay? So now for Singapore to do well, help the villages to buy your products, India, China, and so on. The same issue is happening in China now. Unless they develop the countryside, they're stuck because the export industries are in serious overproduction. They have capacities which you cannot. There's no absorption. Global economy is stagnated. And this is a global issue, right? You know, Piketty has made this point very clear. The accumulation of wealth has been so disproportionate that aggregate demand in everywhere else, including middle class, has declined. Therefore, economic stagnation. So this issue of economic stagnation is not going to go away because it is a structural issue. And unless we relate that to biophilia, that is, how do we organize human life, we are not going to solve this problem. So I urge you all to think beyond the kinds of the way we frame the questions of human relationship to nature and nature's necessities and so on. I think we have to think larger. My fear is that we are not thinking large enough.
Steven has a response.
I take exception to that suggestion. I don't think there's anything that's been said that suggests that a parochial, elitist, urban-oriented only a perspective on biophilia is a theory of human evolution and biology. And as such, it talks about all humanity, not segments of humanity. And the fundamental need that humans have as a consequence of their evolution to affiliate with the non-human environment of which we remain a part. And as a consequence, everything that we've said and everything that is said about biophilia by definition applies to all humans. Now the strategy for accomplishing and affecting that relationship in a way that is beneficial to all people and how that conflates with economy and government is something we can debate to the cows come home, but which is a whole other discussion. But by definition, biophilia embraces all humans because it talks to the biology of what it means to be a human being and a full and flourishing one. Just like to add one other point that's a different point, but I think it's an important one that I think means somewhat reinforcing. It's kind of interesting. In 400 or 500 years ago, the age of exploration, nature was seen as large parts of nature on the planet was seen as unexplored and undiscovered. It was kind of a distorted view of rest of the planet from the point of view of those who were doing the exploration, that it was somehow wilderness out there and people were discovering it. And then we set about exploring it and colonizing it for all practical purposes everywhere in the globe, except for some mountaintops and polar regions, for the most part, by being able to bring our energy into those areas. Ironically, now it seems to me that we've turned it around, and that the area that is now on, the wilderness is unexplored, and that needs to be rediscovered and somehow come to terms with, is not the world out there, but the world in here. You know, as I said before, ad nauseum I've said, that the habitat that we occupy today, the natural habitat, so to speak, of humans today, is the indoor built environment. And as little as we know about how to create compatible, mutually reinforcing relationships between people and nature outside, where the natural and human environments interface, we know far more about that than how to bring that experiential connection to nature in a mutually positive way in the indoor built environment. This is the new wilderness that is relatively unexplored and unknown, that somehow we have to come to understand and develop the methodologies for bringing that connection into the spaces that we spend most of our time. This is the new frontier, so to speak. And I think we have some examples of how that can be done. You know, there's some green walls and there's some indoor riparian areas, and there's some simulations and use of materials, but it's very, very superficial and fragmentary, and it's a world of opportunity for everything from architects to ecologists to figure out how to create a meaningful experiential connection to nature in the context that we live most of our lives, which is this frontier of the indoor environment.
I just chime in and say it's sort of exciting to see there. We have a number of new insights about the ecology of indoor environments, and a lot of work in microbiological habitats and entomological insects and micro, lots of new perspectives on what makes a healthy indoor form of nature, which is very exciting. But I wanted to come back and actually just say, address the other question about, there are profound social injustices and inequalities in the world. And if this is an agenda that's only about greening rich, affluent cities, then it's not terribly relevant, I think. I mean, so my notion of biophilic cities is one that understands these green interventions, the connections with nature, as in part about uplifting and enhancing quality of life for everyone. I probably don't emphasize enough the examples from cities, perhaps more in the developing world, less affluent cities, but there are lots of them. And so it's everything from food producing gardens and rooftops in Mexico City to incorporation of nature into favela, redevelopment programs in Brazil, slums of Brazil, favelas, ways that nature can, in fact, improve the quality of life for all of us, not just for some. So that's a really important perspective.
I just want to add to that, because there are some very good examples. Curitiba is one. I visited Curitiba. The other is Mondragon in Lawrence Gate, right? Where you have an economy in which cooperatively owned, 100,000 factory workers own the economy of the whole region, and they have achieved a kind of balance between their urban settlements and the surrounding natural environment and farms. And the other major area to really look at is Kerala, right? Southern India. And for me, the great inspiration is actually the Emilia-Romagna area in northern Spain, northern Italy, stretching from Rimini, Milan to Rimini, right? Where Bologna, University of Bologna, is the center of it. Where the kind of urbanism, right, is not the kind of urbanism of a New York or even of a Singapore. And yet, the tremendous quality of life, closely related to the food culture, the agriculture, the intellectual development, the design culture, and so on. Now, that's a kind of model of a rural-urban integration, right? Which goes beyond the kind of big city interventions that we tend to think that biophilia is derived from that sort of environment. I think we need scholastically to look at other examples beyond the big city environment. Because I think quite clearly we should be clear about this, that in big city environments, the interventions are actually quite puny, right? We should look at Cuba, for example, right? Which is a very interesting laboratory because of the blockade, and yet despite that, they managed to eke out a balance between the rural and the urban. So I think that because there are so many young people here, for me, from my point of view, it would be a disservice to them if we only communicate to them that it is about, you know, green walls and plants on the windowsill. I don't think it has to go much beyond that.
I think that's a good note to end today's session. Peter will have the last word. Yes.
Okay. If we didn't address the provisions earlier, and I wanted to quickly say something about that I think the professions that have to change most whenever an innovation comes are the ones that are nearest to it. And so I wouldn't be seeking out ones that are far away from this issue. The architects, the planners, the land use, the landscape planners, the property managers, the people who estimate, how much materials you need for any project. These are the ones who control urban development at the moment, and it is a new wilderness that we're approaching. That the problem is we have manuals for how to do it. We know how to build cities. We've been to university and we've learned, and we've got the credentials, and we belong to professional societies, and it's all there. We don't actually. We have to think again. We need some humility in those professions and start to think again about new evidence for how to rebuild our cities. But I think it starts very much from below, and I would add to this whole debate that we're having now about the structures for it. It has to be in every city, in every kind of city, in every kind of politics. We cannot wait for collaborative, cooperative societies to come before we start to act. It is possible to act, I believe, in every kind of political situation. And high capitalism needs to change as much as high socialism. There is no model that I've seen in Cuba or the cooperatives of Spain and Italy that has sorted this out. It is a new set of issues, and it's not going to come from the God planner that produces a new kind of city and drops it down there. But it's going to come from below. It's going to come from all of our professions and our scientists and our local governments working away at how to come up with new sets of regulations, new kinds of facilitating, new ways of financing to enable biophilic urbanism to be mainstream.
I think that's a really, really nice place to end today's discussion. We have somehow got ourselves onto the new frontiers for biophilia and cities, and all the way from, you know, the global scale to the plant on your windowsill. So I think we have covered a lot of ground today. I'd like to thank our wonderful panelists for teaching me so much about biophilic cities today. And
thank you all for being such a great audience and staying to the end. Thank you.
Thank you to all panel members and to Dr. P for moderating the session. May I request that you all remain on stage for a while longer. Ladies and gentlemen, we're coming to almost a close of our symposium. To close the session, we'd like to invite Dr. Lina Chan to present our speakers with a token of appreciation. Namely, a publication, Rainforest in the City by Dr. Chua E. Kiam. May I also then request the speakers and Dr. Key to remain on stage after that for a photo-taking session. First, I would like to call upon Professor Stephen Kellett, and let's give him a round of applause. Professor Kellett, would you like to receive the token of appreciation, please? Next, Professor Tina Tibet, please. Professor Peter Newman. Mr. Q. Sinko. Mr. Q. Oh, thanks. Then it's Professor T. And last but not least, Mr. Janet N. We have all the speakers and the people of our photo session in the front. Thank you very much for taking the time to attend today. Well, those of you who are here, and we hope to see you again at future events. Well, for those who are concerned, for participants who are expected to get, maybe some of you who are still around, to get CPD and CU points for your attendance, please proceed to the registration desk outside. And with that, I wish all of you a very good afternoon, and thank you.